I want to read to you something that I've been reading through the book of Acts over this last month. And Pastor Carter and I have been talking about especially the ending of the book of Acts 27 and 28. But as I was reading through all these chapters, there is one clause that I want to read to you. We would call it in English a parenthetical clause. It's a clause that is bracketed by these parentheses that literally is just kind of a byproduct of the verse. And when I saw this, God began just to speak to my own heart and remind me that really his stops and what he does is all protected and is all overseeing our lives and superintending our lives in an amazing way. You may not see it in your Bible. The phrase will be there, but maybe the parentheses are not, but you'll see what the Bible says. And like I said, when I say a parentheses, it's just kind of a little byproduct, and I want to read this to you. So let me just give you a little bit of background. In chapter 21, Paul is preaching in the temple in Jerusalem. Some Jews came and grabbed him and wanted to kill him in chapter 21, verse 31. The Romans of that area came and rescued Paul, and then for the next five chapters, Paul is on trial. He is now defending himself before the mob, before the Jews, before the Jewish council, before Felix, and finally before King Agrippa. And so right in the middle of these court proceedings, this is the verse that I want to just read to you and really just bring some encouragement to you today. Acts chapter 25, look with me at verse 1. The Bible says that Festus, then having arrived in the province 3 days later, went up to Jerusalem from Caesarea. And the chief priests and the leading men of the Jews brought charges against Paul, and they were urging him and requesting a concession against Paul that they might have him, talking about Paul, brought to Jerusalem to be put on trial. Now, this is what I'm reading out of a New American Standard Version. And the only reason I'm saying that, because all those the Bibles that you have in your lap will read this, but just my Bible puts it in parentheses, and this is what it says. At the same time, there were some people setting an ambush to kill him on the way. Just think about this now. Paul is in the midst of trial. He is in the midst of defending himself and defending the gospel, and people want to send him to Jerusalem. Paul neither knows nor the leadership knows that there is an ambush that is waiting for Paul, that if he gets on the road going to Jerusalem, they will kill him. And nobody knows what's happening except God. At the same time, while Festus is deciding how to deal with them, there is this plot that wants to ambush him. And this parenthesis that's put here in our Bible is basically what Paul did not see, something that was happening behind the scenes, literally to take him down and to take out the Apostle Paul. That there was a group of Jews trying to get him into Jerusalem so they can kill him on the way. Make no mistake about it, Times Square Church. The plan of Satan, according to Jesus, is to steal, to kill, and to destroy. That's what his plan is. That's the ambush that the enemy has and plotted, not for apostles and pastors, but for every single one of us to find a way to take us out. But the problem is that so many times we're looking at the front door and forget the parentheses that God is protecting us from on all the things that you never know about what God is already doing on our behalf. We are so ready to praise him for what we know, we have forgot to praise him for what we don't know he's doing for us. When I left Detroit, one of the last things, talk about a front door and a front assault attack, that when our executive pastor in Detroit, while I was in Minneapolis and interviewing somebody for a possible position at the church, it was our executive pastor at our church that talked about the enemy coming through the front door. Some of you know the story that our executive pastor had somebody break into his house at 3 a.m. in the morning while his family was out, thank God, and he hears the window broken, and literally it was the enemy trying to take out his life. A man he has never met, never been to Detroit, broke into his house looking for drug money. Just one block from where Cindy and I and our four children live, we could see their front door from our back door through the alley. Some man broke into their home. He hears him. He comes down the steps. The man grabs the largest kitchen knife and meets him on the stairs and starts to stab our executive pastor 37 times. he gets him in the stomach and begins to rip up his stomach. Then in his back near the spinal cord, another 12 times. Up at the chin, another 6 times to try to kill and debilitate him. And then the man went to rot, left him on the floor in his own blood and went to rot. This is my friend. This is our executive pastor. I'm out of town. Cindy and the kids are by themselves, and this is going on, and nobody knows that this is happening until they get a phone call from his wife who says, what is happening to Kevin? They said he's in the hospital, but they won't give me any information. So when we finally find out that he's been stabbed 37 times, the plot of the enemy was not just to hurt him, but it was to take him out. It was an ambush. And the miracle of this whole thing is that when he is laying there on the floor, talk about the miracle of God. When he's laying there on the floor in his own blood, he said he was saying his own prayer to God just before he was about to die and just go, God, before I die, please don't let my children be bitter with the ministry and think that God, that these kind of things, Lord God, is that you're not with us. And God, let my wife know that I love her. And then he said he heard a voice. He doesn't even know if it was verbal, audible. And the voice said to him, they still need you. And all of a sudden, he says, and not to be graphic, he says he held his intestines in place while the man was on the second floor, and somehow by the strength of God, got up, walked out the door to his neighbors at 3:30 in the morning, who happened to be up. I don't even know. The other miracle is for a neighbor to open up a door for somebody that looks like that. Because I would be going like, I don't know if I can really do it, if I want to be part of this miracle. But what happens is this man calls 911. They pick him up. They get him to the hospital. The doctor says that they've never seen anything like this before. Stabbed 37 times, and not one of those hit a vital organ of his body. That's a miracle. Even though the enemy tried to ambush him, God was working a miracle. The other miracle that he told me after this happened was that when the police saw him, they said they couldn't even recognize his ethnicity. They didn't know whether he was black, Asian, Hispanic. He was so covered in blood. They were so outraged of a human that can do this to him, that with their guns drawn, this is in the police report, they walked into the house, saw the giant puddle where he was laying as they were looking for the man who already fled the house. And they wrote in the report, we don't understand this. We see where he stood up in his own blood, but we can't see any footprints from the puddle of blood to the neighbor's house. He says we don't see a size 10 foot. That they said, this is in the police room, we see the blood, but we don't know how you got there to the neighbor's house. Remember that silly little painting called Footprints in the Sand? This is the ghetto version called Footprints in the Blood that got him to where he needs to be. Only God can do something like that. What the enemy tried to do in ambushing him, God said, I have another plan for your life. Only God. Back to Paul. Verse 4 of Acts 25 says, then Festus then answered that Paul was being kept in custody at Caesarea and that he was about to leave shortly. Whether we don't know if that's Festus or Paul, but to leave shortly for where? Keep this in mind. We call it the Jerusalem assassination, the parentheses that Paul didn't even know it was happening. Festus didn't even know. But somehow the enemy put together a parenthesis that says, I am going to get ready to ambush you in Jerusalem. You get on that path, you get on that road, you will die. You're going to be killed. Just in that little parenthesis, Paul is just there trying to defend himself. He is speaking and all of a sudden has no idea that what's happening miles away from him, that somebody is plotting even to kill his life. What should Paul have been worried? Well, the reason why I don't think Paul was worried about it, even though he didn't know it, and why you don't have to worry about the parentheses, is because really Paul was in the witness protection program. Because when you start testifying against criminals, they know then all of a sudden your life is at stake, so they've got to send you, change your identity, change who you are, so now you are no longer the person you used to be, but they've changed your name, put you in a new place, in a new position, and the government says, we will protect you from anybody that you've testified against. Well, since Acts chapter 9, Paul has been testifying against the thief called Lucifer, saying that he has come to steal, to kill, and destroy. At that moment, God goes, you're in the witness protection program. Now, I have changed you from the inside out. You're not the Saul that you used to be. You're the Paul now that's going to be now changing this entire continent. And the moment you accept Jesus inside of your heart, you are not the same person. And God says, no matter what rises up against you, God goes, I got this, I got you. And there could be 10,000 enemies that come against you. But like David said, 10,000 will fall by my right hand. Another 10,000 here, because my life is now in God's witness protection program with him. Doesn't even know. You don't know. I don't even know what's come against us. Back to Paul. Verse 5, therefore he said, let the influential men among you go there with me. And if there is anything wrong about this man, let them prosecute him. Verse 6, and after he had spent not more than 8 or 10 days among them, he went to Caesarea, and on the next day, Festus took his seat on the tribunal and ordered Paul to be brought. Once again, he is about to testify. The parentheses said that there's an ambush waiting for him. And Paul arrived. The Jews who had come down from Jerusalem stood around him, bringing many serious charges against him, which they could not prove. Verse 8, and while Paul said in his own defense, I've committed no offense against either the law or the Jews or against the temple or against Caesar, but Festus, verse 9, wishing to do the Jews a favor, answered Paul and said, are you willing to go to Jerusalem, which we don't want him to go to? Are you willing to go to Jerusalem and stand trial before me on these charges? Now remember, if he goes there, it's an ambush that's waiting for him. So nobody knows what's happening, not even Festus. Festus is not even saying, I want you to go to Jerusalem because I know they're going to kill you and get you out of my hair. It's nothing like that. What he knows is that I just want you to stand trial. Paul doesn't know there's an ambush. Festus doesn't know there's an ambush. But I have a sense that the enemy has put that parenthesis there to say, I've got to take this man out because he's changing people's lives. Verse 10, Paul said, I'm standing before Caesar's tribunal where I ought to be tried. I've done no wrong to the Jews, as you also very well know. And here's the last verse I want to read to you. If then I am a wrongdoer and have committed anything worthy of death, I do not refuse to die. But if none of these things are true, which these men accuse me, no one can hand me over to them. Then listen to this, Times Square Church. Then four words he speaks that literally saves his life, and he doesn't even know that these are the words that saves his life. He just simply goes, I appeal to Caesar. And when you say that, everything, Paul just goes, I haven't done anything wrong, but if you have to die, I'll die, but I appeal to Caesar. Who knew at that point that what he was saying was literally the words that God put in his mouth, because God was going to put him in Rome, save him from an ambush, put him in a cell for 2 years in Rome, that he can still encourage the church. And here's the promise that Jesus gave to his disciples, Matthew 10:19. When you are arrested, don't worry what to say at your trial, for you will be given the right words at the right time. That you don't even know that what you're saying has been led by me. That when people come before you and you're thinking, what do I say? I'm being written up at my job, written up at my campus because I've said something about Jesus. Jesus says, don't worry, because there's going to be stuff that you say that you didn't even plan on saying, that it's going to be the exact words that you need to get you out of this situation, that I appeal to Caesar, instead of saying, I mean, think about this. I appeal to Caesar changes the whole direction. Brother Dave Wilkerson told one of the most fantastic stories, and I think he said he met the lady that said it, this 82-year-old woman. Talk about it, I appeal to Caesar, not knowing what you're saying. She said she was living in one of the boroughs here in New York. And while she was there, 82 years old, living by herself, just like Kevin did, our pastor, hears someone break through the front door. And she didn't know what to do. And so the top of her bedroom is at the top, the bedroom is at the top of the stairs. She looks down and sees the man kick open her door. And what do? You're 82 years old. The man's about to steal everything you have. And she looks down from the top of the stairs and just started saying, Acts 2:38, Acts 2:38, Acts 2:38, Acts. And the man got down on the floor, spread his arms until she called the police, and the police came and arrested the man. Because the verse just says, repent and believe in Jesus. And he's laying on the ground because the 82-year-old woman kept going, Acts 2:38, Acts 2:38, Acts. And she said it until he got on the floor and he was there. And here's what's great. Brother Dave said, the cops asked the man, they started laughing. They said, what? This is an 82-year-old woman. Why did you wait for us to come? He said, listen, if you knew a lady had an axe and 2:38s, I would have waited. Hallelujah! You don't even know how God is putting words in your mouth. I appeal to Caesar, saved his life. Back to Paul. Did Paul go to Rome? Or Jerusalem, he went to Rome. Probably one of the greatest messages I've ever heard on the book of Acts is from Acts 27 from Pastor Carter on Paul's journey on the boat ride in Acts 27:1, that they said they're about to sail him to Italy. That from that point on, those four words, just like those four words, I appeal to Caesar, was Acts 2:38 for him. Who would have known? Who would have known that those simple words would have saved Paul's life? You have a Festus that wants him in Jerusalem, but unaware of an assassination. You have men that are setting an ambush, and Paul, and nobody knows anything about this. And all this was based upon Paul beginning to say something that maybe just God put upon his heart. Death was waiting for him, but God was working for him. And one of the things that I kept thinking about is there are so many things that are happening against us, but there are so many things happening for us that we don't even know about. We don't know about the parentheses that God has saved us from. Death was waiting for him, but God was working with. That's why I really do think that 500-year-old song from John Newton really does mean something. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace that brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me and you home. Thank you, Jesus. If we could see how much God is protecting you and me, it would probably strike fear in us. But there are plots that the enemy has put in parentheses that we will never see, and God shields us from. But God says, you don't even have to worry about it. Pray and let God worry about it. Pray and go to sleep. God's going to be up all night anyway, and he's the one that works in our behalf. And somehow we've got to understand that when something happens and there is a delay in the Lincoln Tunnel, you need to just go, this is a parenthesis. When the plane at LaGuardia is late for the 98th time, this is God doing something. When you're on the BQE and you're sitting there going, I can't believe it, just may be God going, there's a parenthesis. You have no idea what's happening. There's a hotel that says no more vacancies. You got to go somewhere. Who knows what God is doing? Our job is not to figure it out. I don't know what happened on that plane. I don't know what God was doing. All I knew was to go, God, you know everything that's coming against me, and but yet you are for me. Hallelujah. God is for us. Two thoughts, and then I want us to close today. Listen, two thoughts. Sometimes we just need to thank God for taking care of stuff we don't even know about. Sometimes we just need to stop and just go, God, I have thanked you for everything that you've done, but God, I just need to thank you for the stuff I don't even know what you're doing. And you are working on our behalf. There are things, thousands of things that God is doing. And some of you are thinking here, you're going like, Pastor Tim, I have a hard enough time with the stuff I know. Now you're telling me there's stuff I don't know? What kind of message is this? I could barely make it. Now you're saying there's a thousand other things that are trying to ambush my life. Man, this is the worst Sunday service I've ever been to. I can't even believe this. But you have to understand that God is for us. That we sometimes need to realize it is God's doing and it's God's working for us. That all God wants you to do is just to say thank you, to share just the energy to go, God, thank you for what you're doing. Thank you. There is always something to praise him about. There is always something to thank him about. There is always something to lift your hands. That when those songs are being sung today, this is not the position you assume. This is the position you assume and say, God, thank you for what you're doing. A few years ago, I was taking my littlest one. It was just me and her. And so when you're with dad, you just kind of do stuff that Cindy's here. So now she knows, but... So she goes, would you get me French fries and a vanilla shake at McDonald's? So I knew we had time and Cindy wouldn't know other than today. So I just said, absolutely. I said, sure. I said, and it's just once again, just puts a good check for dad and just. So the fries just came out. And so they're hot. She's sitting in the back and that smell is. It's intoxicating. And so I just go, hey, I said, can I have a few of those fries? And literally, she just goes, absolutely not. I said, just give me a fry. She goes, no, you bought them for me. I said, just a fry. Just give me one. Nothing. And finally, I pulled the car over. And I just go, do you know why you have those fries? I said, let me help you. I said, I get up every morning at 5 a.m. to pray, to get a word from God so I can show up at church, preach my heart out, then counsel people throughout the week. And then when Friday comes, they give me a paycheck. With that paycheck, I make sure you have Cheerios so you don't starve. I make sure I pay the electric bill so you're not sitting here in the dark. I pay the heating bills so you don't freeze. I pay health insurance so you can get a physical. I said, I'm paying for stuff. And then with the money left over, I pull into the drive-thru so you can get a vanilla shake and a set of fries. I said, you should be singing praises to my name for all that I have done on your behalf. And you said, no. I said, I should take the shake and the fries right now, and I just need one fry. And sometimes we forget all that God has done, and we won't even give him a praise. He deserves the praise. He deserves the praise. Hallelujah. To sit there, you sit with your shake and fries while they're singing their heart out, thinking, I bought this. You didn't buy anything. God gave it to us. God is so humble. He is so humble that he's so content to not blow his own horn, but to leave it for us to begin to magnify him. He's not the one going, I did that, I did. If I was God, I'd be going, I did that, I did that. I was reading James this week, and the Bible says James is the brother of Jesus, but he wouldn't even say that. James said, James, a bondservant of Jesus. I'm going like, James, you wouldn't even exploit that you're the brother of Jesus. I totally would have been all over that. Tim, Jesus is my brother. If you need anything, just call me. I know the Son of... But there's a downside to that. Can you imagine being Jesus's brother? Why can't you be like your big brother? He never argues. His room's always clean. The chores are already done. You're so... That's why James didn't get saved till after the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's why we need to praise him even for the things we don't see. That's why sometimes while you're sitting there in service with your shake and your fries, you need to put them down and say, God, you've provided more for me than I have ever known, that I can ever do, that when that choir comes, it's what God has called us to do. That's why I'm here to tell you, why should I feel discouraged and why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home? When Jesus is my portion, a constant friend is he. His eye is on the sparrow and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. His eye is on the sparrow. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm done. Just somebody come to the piano. Listen, if I look at this world, I'll be distressed. If I look at myself, I'll be depressed. But if I look at Jesus, I find rest in him. It's his providence. It's God working on our behalf. It's God doing this. So the first thing I tell you is this: praise him for what you don't even know what's happening. Praise him for the parentheses. Praise him and say, God, I don't even know why the train is late. I don't even know why that car is full of people on this car on the A train. Some reason you want me in the other car. I don't know, God. There could be a parenthesis. All I know is your eye is on the sparrow and you're watching me. And I finish with this. Just think this through for a moment with me. Whoever has the keys decides when we leave. Whoever has the keys decides when it's over with. And the Bible says in Revelation 1:18 that the resurrected Jesus, listen to this, the living one was dead, and behold, he is alive, and he has the keys of death and hell. Whoever has the keys decides when life is over. Jesus said in John 10, no man takes my life from me. I lay it down. That's why the words of George Whitefield is something that I started to live by. He just simply said this: I'm immortal until God calls me home. Think of that. I'm immortal. You can't decide when I leave because you don't hold the keys. The bully in your school doesn't hold your keys. The stalker that you, some of you are afraid of, doesn't have the keys. The person that you think is dangerous, that lives in your apartment, they don't have the keys. Until they can die and raise from the dead, they don't get any keys. And what's amazing is that I used to be afraid until I realized that he has the keys. And I was riding on a plane back to Lafayette, Louisiana, getting ready to preach. And while we were on the plane, this little plane started hitting all this turbulence. And it's amazing how many people are Christians on a plane when that thing starts going down and everybody's like, you would think this was a choir on the plane. Everybody, Jesus, help us, Jesus, oh, Jesus. I'm going, this is like a Christian plane. Everybody knows Jesus on this plane. I knew that God had a word in my heart to preach that Sunday. And because God gave me a word, I knew that that plane had to land. And so everybody, I wanted to turn around and go, everybody gets to live. Because I'm on the plane, I'm supposed to be on the ground, I get to preach because I'm immortal. My life is not in the turbulence, my life is not in cancer's hand, my life is not in the doctor's report, my life is in the one who holds the keys of death, hell,
and the grave. Let's all stand together. And can we just praise him for a moment and say, God, you are worthy.
Paul said it this way. Listen to for just a moment. In Romans chapter 8, this is what he said. Listen. He said, and this phrase just stuck out to me. Listen to the words. Romans 8:31. What shall we say to these things? And he was speaking about death, tribulation, trial. He was speaking to all those things that can come. Romans 8:31. He goes, what shall we say? Like he was saying, I'm going to give you a vocabulary when things come against you. That's what the Bible says. What shall we say to these things? What shall we say when you get out of work late, you're waiting in a subway terminal, and you're thinking, God, what shall we say to fear? What shall we say to the parentheses? And here's what Paul says. Ready for this? Romans 8:31. What shall we say to these things? Next phrase. If God be for us, who can be against? That's what he says your language is. He says, that's your language. He says, that's your vocabulary. He says, what shall we say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? Would you bow your head for just a moment right now? I started to praise him for the stuff I don't even know about. I started to praise him and to say, God, there's stuff that's happening that I don't even know. And words that I say, who knows how many trials and how many Jerusalem highways it took me off of to put me back on the road that I'm supposed to be. And here's what I want to just tell you today. Listen, if you are just weighted down right now going, God, I don't know how I'm going to get out of this situation. Here's what I want to encourage you with. If that's one, can I just tell you, there are 10,000 things that he has shielded you from, protected you from, and said if one is bearing you down, think of the 10,000 that he has held away from you and said, let me just get you through one while I protect you from 1,000 of those things that could come your way. And can I just tell you, if he is protecting you from 10,000 things, he can get you through this thing right now. But we have forgotten, I have forgotten all that he has done, what I don't see. Because all I do is go, God, this is what's happening. God, this is what's happening. God, this is what's happening. And I have forgotten. I have forgotten the ambushes. I have forgotten the diversions. I have forgotten the traffic. I have forgotten the holdups and the delays. And going, God, you know what? This is my appeal to Caesar. This is my Acts 2:38. Who knows what you are protecting me from? In that hotel, on that plane, in that individual, in that meeting. Oh, that business meeting. They canceled the meeting. Who knows what was in the parentheses? Only God knows. And instead of accusing God, you don't care, the opposite could be true right now. He cares so much that he's protecting us. And if you're here right now and just go, Pastor Tim, it makes sense now. This one thing is weighing me down, but if he has protected me from 10,000 things, I know he's going to get me through this one. And so God's given me a new vocabulary now, Pastor Tim. What shall we say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? And if you're here right now and that thing you're carrying seems to weigh you down, seems to come and bring distress, anxiety, fear, even doubt, I'm going to ask you now to cast that upon Jesus and just say, my new phrase is not, where are you? My new phrase is not, God, how come? And my new phrase is not, God, why has this happened? But I learned in church today what to say to these things. If God be for me, who can be against me? He holds the keys. And whoever holds the keys decides when this thing is over. Nobody else decides it. There's not a person, a disease, an individual, ISIS. There's not a terrorist. There's not a dirty bomb. There's nothing. They don't hold the keys. Jesus holds the keys today. And as Greg just is going to lead us in that song, if we can go back, Greg, that song, the Kurt Carr song, Faithful, that third part when we go from the holy, and then we go to that faithful. That's the part I like. If you're here right now and just say, Pastor Tim, this load seems to be a lot, but today it just got a little bit lighter because I realized, if God be for me, who could be against me? And that load may have cancer on it. That load may have a divorce on it. That load may have this bondage. That load may have, I don't know what the future holds. But now I realize that one thing, if that one thing is, thank God he's got 10,000 things that he's working in my behalf. But today I come to him and I just say, if God be for me, who can be against me? And we're going to cast that care upon him today. We're going to cast it upon him today. You know what the world has? If you don't know Jesus today, you know the only thing that you have is to hold on to your friend as you're going down this scary moment. I don't have to hold on to a friend. I hold on to him, God's unchanging hand. And this is that moment. If you're in the annex, if you're here to go, you know what? They can't get me through this, but there's one that can get me through this. And if you're here today to say, this is the day I cast all my care upon him today, because he's got everything. If God be, my language changes today. If that's you as Greg sings this, I want to pray for you today and say, Pastor Tim, today it changes for me. I'm not leaving depressed. I'm not leaving distressed. I'm going to leave in rest today. And if that's you, I want you to get out of your seat right now. Balcony, main floor, I want to pray for you as we sing this. Quickly, you come. Balcony, I want you on the main floor. If that's you as we sing this, that God is faithful. Come on, sing this as you come. Just lift our hands and just thank him for the stuff that we don't even know about right now. Father, there's parentheses that are bracketed over every one of our lives that, God, today we don't even have to worry about because you got us today. If your eye is on the sparrow, I know he watches over me. Come on, just tell him, just say, I know you watch over me right now. Tell him right now, I know you watch over me. I want to pray for you before Greg leads us, and I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. Listen, I want you to say this with me right now. Say, Jesus, I praise you for the things I don't know. Thank you. Every ambush, every enemy attack that I don't even know about, you got this. You got me. I thank you. With my hands raised, my voice is lifted up. You have the keys of hell and death. So you're in charge of the end of the story. You are the author and the finisher of my faith. So today I praise you. I cast my care upon you. You are in charge. Nobody else. Not disease. Not plots. You are in charge. So I give you the praise that you will take me home through many dangers, toils, and snares. I have already come. And you're going to get me through the next phase. In Jesus' name. Come on, let's thank him right now. Come on.